Okay, so we actually should be. So tonight we're going to look at George Berkeley. And then the second section of the class will look at David Hume. So two British empiricists tonight. George Berkeley is a...
Well, let me pull up the old Wikipedia site for George.
Gnarls
Berkeley?
Charles Berkeley.
I know a Gnarls Berkeley. He's the one that sings, "I think you're crazy."
Charles Berkeley?
Who's Charles
Berkeley? Played for the Phoenix Suns. An incredible
basketball player. Basketball. That's one of those sports that you see on TV, right?
Yes. And he ended up with a radio show kind of a thing. Now, he was an amazing player. He just wasn't surrounded or on the right team.
What I know about basketball is if you're losing the game, you could use a full court press in the last inning to get the winning touchdown.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
I'm kidding.
Make the last goal.
I grew up in Philly, and we had the Eagles and the Sixers and Flyers and Phillies. And I was in the chess team. We didn't have a mascot or anything. Mascot? You know, like the Golden Rams. We were the Golden Rams, but we never went to the team matches with any mascot or anything. We beat a lot of places. Pardon?
Our debate team?
Yes.
Seawolves?
Yes.
Oh, Seawolves? Who would have ever thought of a team?
When the internet first really started, I had a web page on, my web page was from 95, this page, the one I use. And the server for UAA was C. Wolf.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Not SEA, but C. Wolf.
Oh, okay.
.UAA. .Alaska.edu or whatever. And my home computer I had on Prodigy, which was at the time that was owned by Sears.
Soon to be extinct.
Yeah, and I guess it was bought by IBM or whatever, but so it was Prodigy. Well, when I came home and I wanted to log on to my web page, it wouldn't allow me. It wouldn't find my website. And I had to email them to find out why, and it turned out that they thought anything that the server was called Seawolf was a porn site. But when I told them, no, it's the website for my university, they said, oh, okay. So they let me go to it. And that was kind of
so much for research.
It's the way that machines work. Okay, so George, I know he thinks of himself as Irish, so he's an Irish philosopher, but guess what? His parents were from England. So they were actually British that had moved to Ireland. So that puzzles me. Is he officially Irish then? I don't know if strictly speaking, I'm English, Irish, Swedish, German, and French, says my mother. You can trust the women to tell you where you're really from. But it puzzles me because the Irish that I have is Scotch-Irish. And those are people that left Scotland and went to Ireland, and so they were basically kicked out of Scotland because they pissed everybody off there. And so then they were kicked out to Ireland where they pissed everybody off there. And then the
survivors went to the colonies where the U.S. pissed everybody off there, you know, how they do. So, mostly in Tennessee now. There are other Jamisons in Alaska, so that's kind of... But, so officially he's Irish. He's a friend of the author of Gulliver's Travels, Jonathan Swift, right? So they're schoolmates, etc. And Jonathan Swift already has a noble who's his sponsor, and you had to have a noble who was your sponsor in order to publish in their locale. And so Barclay was recommended by Jonathan Swift and accepted and was able to publish. His first publication was on vision. And I believe it. Yeah, so an essay towards a new theory of vision, which is there. And the main thing about that, I suppose, as I understand it, is that he's the one who discovered that the reason we can have depth perception is because we have two eyes. So basically, we get this mathematical convergence of the two eyes that enables us to know that you're farther back than, right? You know, so that seems like that should have been commonsensical, but actually all these kinds of things turn out to have been invented by, discovered by somebody. And that's, you know, like the idea that blood circulates. That's Harvey, right? Are you familiar with Harvey? And all the idea that the blood circulates? We didn't really do very much on any of the medical stuff. I don't know what happens here. It was kind of a slow process. This of course is a little bit earlier, but he's first begins noticing that the heart is a pump. Then the question is, well, if it's a pump, what's it pumping? Right? So it took him like 10 years to come to conclude that the blood is actually flowing around in a, like a kind of a...
10 years.
About 10 years, as I recall.
Doesn't that imply that he's a little bit slow?
He actually wasn't very persuasive. Many of his fellow medical doctors thought, you're nuts.
So
you know,
10 years for him to...
Well, 10 years for him to come to that next conclusion, but then it took still further before everyone else accepted it as... Yeah, so some of the things that we think are absolutely basic are actually heat. You know, it's famous, you know, Hobbes, for example, Thomas Hobbes thought that heat was transferred because there's kind of a flow of stuff that is what makes heat. Phlogiston was what they called it, right? And so it's all kinds of... But one of the doctors, I don't know if I mentioned him, that was very famous in this time period is... Dr. Meyer, although it's spelled differently... he was originally from Switzerland, Geneva. Oh, I'm actually in the book. Oh, that's interesting. So this is a book by Hugh Trevor Roper, who was a great British historian, Europe's physician, The Various Life of Sir Theodore de Mayerne. So, but Meyer... Yeah, it depends. I've seen like three or four different spellings of it. It was a French, it was Swiss, became a French doctor, treated the king, was the court physician, and against an awful lot of the other physicians. There was virtual warfare between the different schools of physicians, because he was a physicalist, believed that there were physical properties in like the foods we eat and in our bodies that accounted for our health, whereas the other physicians were of the theory that basically it was whether you prayed sufficiently, beat your body up enough that you have God's grace that you're going to be healthy or not, right? So if you're wounded by a sword and it gets festered, infected, right? And what you have to do is pray over that sword, the right prayers to cure that. But he was convinced that there were like chemicals that we needed in the body, so you actually needed to ingest certain things in order to have health. That's not, you know, that was outrageous. Just outrageous. You know, so this is a fascinating book in that light. You know, because you don't realize just how significantly different the world was. The idea of moving it towards a physical, scientific world was an incredibly political process, not just experiment and stuff. But after the king died, he fled from France and went to England, where he became the court physician there for the king, and became really a rich man. He even had his own observatory in his house. He had like a tower, the astronomical observatory and stuff, so kind of interesting. He lived pretty old, etc. So there's that kind of thing. And Berkeley, apart from his work on vision, would also later on come up with a theory that quinine, he called it tar water, so the medicinal properties of tar water, that if you ingested tar water, it would be good for your health. And so it's kind of like the stuff that medicine men would sell that would get them ridden out of town, tar and feathered and stuff. But he is on to something, the idea that there's, characteristics of the sap from the quinine that was healthful. So he was, I don't know if that's good stuff or bad, but he was involved in that. But at the same time, he's very concerned that the materialism that John Locke was a proponent of was going to get people in trouble. And the reason for it was John Locke argued, remember, that even though there are only secondary properties that we can actually observe of a thing in our environment, right? The primary qualities of the thing are there, that it's real, right? But the only things I can see, taste, touch, etc., are the way those primary qualities of the thing interacted with my senses, right? So what I'm observing is my senses' reaction to the thing, not that I'm actually perceiving the thing in itself, right? So I'm instead just aware of the way my body, as a human being, perceives the thing, right? But still, Locke was absolutely convinced that the things were really there. And by the way, I think of that as really our kind of American common sense view of things. So, even the question about the tree falling in the forest, does it make a sound even though there's no one there to hear it? Everyone pretty much says, well, yeah, right? That's, I think, John Locke's view, right? The physical tree falling in the forest makes a physical noise, so whether you're actually there and you're hearing it, it really has nothing to do with the fact that the noise is happening there, because it's all physical. The material world is there. But notice, that is just a theory, because according to Locke, you can't actually ever see, hear, taste, touch the physical world. We just assume that there must be such a physical world because we're doing all this observing, right? Right? But Berkeley's concerned because prior to this point, everyone believed, and this is still very medieval, that everything that happens, happens because God is doing it, right? The idea that there's this mechanical world that God created, like the clock, and started it off, and now it's a perfect clock. It's an insult to God to think that he would have made an imperfect clock. You know, so God doesn't have to step in and keep adjusting the clock because it's slow or something, right? You know, so this perfect clock that a perfect God made is just ticking away. So basically, God's done, right? He created the world, and he's no longer involved. You know, he's off doing whatever, right? And the world is merrily trucking along all on its own because all this material substance is perfectly arranged to do what it does, right? So the problem for that, and that's deism, by the way, is that you have no reason to pray to God or to interact with God. You know, please God, I'm falling, please catch me. Not going to help, right? Right? But it used to be that, of course, people thought that God was constantly there and available, so that your prayers essentially were going to make or break what happens. You know, Lord, you know, help me, you know, as I attack this fort, you know, and if God's on your side, then you'll beat the crap out of the fort, you know, et cetera, right? You know, so there's this constant interaction between us and God in the spirit world. And even illnesses, etc., you know, that's why we say God bless you when you sneeze, because we're worried you've lost some of your spirit. There's a vacuum in your body. And if the devil catches on that you've got this empty spot, the devil might fill that space in before God does. So God bless you. You know, make sure God knows that you need some grace right now because you sneezed, right? You know, that's, you know, where that, you know, tradition basically seems to have come from. It sounds silly, but there's all kinds of stuff like that. However, if the material world is operating on its own, then we don't need constant interaction between the world and God. And what that's going to mean is people can stop believing in God. Because after all, it's the world working on its own. I don't need God. I don't need the church to tell me how things are working, says Descartes. I can look at the world for myself and see how it works because it's a machine, right? So, as far as Berkeley's concerned, believing in materialism is going to weaken our dependence on the church and on belief in God. In fact, it's worse if you think about these dialogues. The dialogues are between helos, which is matter, and philonous, which is love of mind, right? And Berkeley's going to argue that everything is the mind of God. And helos is the belief that there's matter, right? So Locke is helos, and Berkeley is philonous. So that's the dialogue, right? And what happens if you are helos is you believe that there's objects out there that I can't know anything about, but nonetheless, I know that they're there and I know they have certain characteristics, the primary qualities. Well, that's a contradiction. There's no way you can, on the one hand, say that there's nothing I can know about those things because everything I know from my empirical experience, my senses, are things that my senses are reacting to something, but I can't actually know the thing, right? But at the same time, I actually know for sure that the thing is there causing that. Well, that turns out to be indefensible. It's a contradiction. And that's what he shows very, very well, actually, in the dialogue. So he succeeds in that. He succeeds in showing that this is a contradictory notion. And it's not only that problem, but the idea that our minds are spirit, whereas Locke's conception of the material world is physical matter, and that's like matter and spirit have no interaction capability, right? Because they don't, you know, so everything that affects your spirit is spirit, not matter. And by the way, being matter, you know, how do we affect matter? Or being spirit, how do we affect matter? You know, that's, of course, the arguments over, you know, that our bodies are material, but our soul is spiritual. that, remember, becomes a conflict, because how does your spirit interact with your body in such a way that you get the body to do stuff? Descartes cannot really solve that problem. That becomes what we call today Descartes' error, right? Well, if that's the case, then we become skeptics. We won't think that we can actually know anything about the world, because it's made out of matter. And not only is it a contradiction to argue that it's made out of matter, but it would also mean that there's no way for it to interact with our mind, which is spirit, right? Well, at this point, I'd like to argue, this is a weird thesis, by the way. I've not found a whole lot of folks that take this tack, but it seems to make absolute sense to me. And that is that, remember, Berkeley is actually writing to Leibniz back and forth. So he's aware of Leibniz, and he's aware of Leibniz's ideas. Remember, Leibniz argues that everything is made up of monads, and the monads are spiritual beings. So he's not a materialist. He's arguing instead that everything is made up of spirit. Right? But remember, I would argue that what we should do is interpret his spirit as energy today. So we're moving from the medieval period, where they're thinking about matter and spirit, to the modern period, where we have mass and energy. And mass is actually energy in an arrangement, right? So really, our own physicists today would be actually on the side of Leibniz and say that, yes, everything is spirit, aka energy, in an arrangement, right? Well, so Berkeley, obviously, in league with Leibniz, is arguing this same point of view, that, you know, it's not physical, material substance that has no way of interacting with our spirit, but instead it's actually spirit. It's energy, too. And so by arguing this, I would be saying that Berkeley is as advanced as Leibniz. We have physicists that look at Leibniz and say, wow, he's actually in total agreement with us, even though he's like 400 years ago. Well, Berkeley is too. So, I mean, it's not 400 years. How many years? Three something, right? 300 something. So, what? This is 307 years ago, right? So, that's still older than any of us, right? So that seems pretty ancient to me. And yet he's basically, now obviously he's not going to know nearly as much as what we do about the nature of that energy, but he's on to something. That the logical answer has to be that our minds are made out of spirit in the same way everything we're interacting with must be made out of spirit, because spirit interacts with spirit. This concept of matter doesn't fit, right? So the mind of God is his concept of this energy. So when we think of the mind of God and we think of the monadology of Leibniz, I think they're just two different ways of saying basically the same scientific approach, that everything is made up of energy. Now, would we today say that the energy of the universe is actually the mind of God? That sounds a lot like Spinoza. Doesn't really sound Christian per se, but nonetheless, that seems to me to be where they're going. So he's concerned that people believing in Locke's materialism will fall away from the church, and what will eventually happen is everyone will become atheistic. And you know, it's actually, I think, very prophetic of Berkeley, because, I mean, it's obviously not the case in the United States, but if you look at Northern Protestant Europe, that pretty much adopted this materialist point of view, that they are, for the most part, not really practicing religious people anymore. It's kind of amazing, but when you read about the situation in England, there are more practicing Islamists in England than there are Anglican members of the church. I think they certainly had a lot to do with it.
For that in 1970, whatever.
Yeah. I think they persuaded a lot of people that you know, the whole narrative, the religious narrative, was comical. And you know, humor is an incredibly powerful tool. And yet, what amazes me is how come no one's made a movie about Muhammad? And it puts Muhammad in, if you think about it, Muhammad was a child rapist. His latest wife was an 11-year-old girl that he raped on the night he married her.
Well, how do you know that he raped her? Maybe she was probably
voluntary. He said, he wrote it down. He wrote that he did.
Okay, I digress.
Well, I mean, I'm not thinking that up. I mean, he's the one that tells folks you should marry, you can have four wives, etc. Trump, he's got three so far.
What?
One and three at a time. One and
nine. Yeah, he's serial monogamous, though. He's one at a time.
But he tends to have this pattern of having the second one while he's having the first.
Yeah, I think there are overlaps.
I'm not sure. I haven't confirmed that with the last one. But it's certainly true of the first two, over a period of roughly 2 years.
Which makes us wonder who else is with him in the White House. Well, let's not go there. Sorry.
Well, that's been a problem in the White House for years.
Yeah, that's why they have a back door, right? That's where Marilyn Monroe used to go in.
Monica Lewinsky.
Actually, JFK went to a hotel where Marilyn Monroe was already.
So they left the White House.
Yeah. JFK.
Yes. I mean, it's got to go back.
Yeah, the president that basically did whatever he wanted in the White House was William Jefferson Clinton. So I think the cigar is still in the drawer, actually.
Because nobody will touch it.
Nobody wants to touch it. So.
And that is totally understandable.
Yeah. I'm sure as Obama was passing off the office to Trump, he said, now this is the drawer with the cigar in it. So. Not messed with that.
Do what you want, and then who knows, it might change now.
So the dialogues are persuasive, I would say, that Locke's philosophy, his materialist philosophy, is not a catastrophe, but is going to lead to problems, and that it's self-contradictory. But he goes on. He doesn't just stop with that. He goes on to argue that everything that does exist. So Berkeley's answer to the tree falling in the forest is that, remember, I read, did I read it for you? Maybe not. Let me read it. It's the little poem. Maybe I didn't read it. I should have it memorized, right? By now. How many times have I read this? Okay. There was a young man who said, God must think it exceedingly odd if he finds that this tree continues to be when there's no one about in the quad. And the answer, the reply, I feel like I should always put in a deeper voice for some reason. Dear sir, your astonishment's odd. I am always about in the quad, and that's why the tree continues to be, since observed by yours faithfully, God. Right? So the mind of God is observing everything in the universe all the time. God or Berkeley? I don't recall Berkeley hearing voices. I had this trouble the last time I looked for it, too.
There's so many other things out there named Sophie's World now. All right, let me try it this way. Barclays.
Ist dann der Major so eine Art Gott für uns?
Ja, irgendwie schon.
Und was ist mit Hebe?
So, Sophie's World, if you're interested, it's really a very popular book. What? That's not it. Shoot. A novel about the history of philosophy. Yes, that's it. So. Oh, shoot. So it's popular. It's written really for younger people. So used to be, I don't know if any of the teachers in the Anchorage School District still use it, but some of the teachers, like there was one at East, there was one at Chugiak, that would do a high school philosophy course that you could, you know, it could be an elective, right, that you could take. And the textbook that they usually used was this book. So this was a young girl, a Swedish girl, whose father is in the UN military. And so he's not at home, he's off in Africa somewhere. But to have a constant relationship with his daughter, he sends her letters. And in the letters, he asks her these weird philosophical questions. But meanwhile, she also has this Alberto, who is a local philosopher in town,
was kind of her guide to helping to answer the questions that her father poses, etc. So, but in the book, she literally ends up going with Alberto into time. So she visits Socrates and learns about Socrates. Yeah, yeah. So it's interesting. It's posed in a way that's great for young people to kind of see Sophie being asked these questions by her father. Who are you? You know, right? What, who am I? You know, what do you mean? Right. But then Alberto takes her to these various philosophers. You know, and so it's like a TV show even that they made in Sweden. It turns out to be a terrific way of introducing philosophy to young people. I remember thinking that, you know, that little scene with Barclay is kind of interesting. It's that they keep using the mirrors, right? Because there's this business of, you know, the reflection. You know, how do you know what you are? Because notice she's at one moment she's in the mirror and the next she's not. So. You know, I think in the book, in that scene, she's literally confused about whether she is herself or the reflection, right? And so, you know, so she's looking back and forth because is Barclay in the mirror or is she in the room with her? Is she one place or the other? So that's kind of just neatly done, I thought. And that cabin is in the middle of a lake, which is behind her house. So rowing her boat out to the cabin is like going into the past of the philosopher. So it's kind of a neat production. But they make Barclay, of course, seem pretty mysterious, as he was actually a very family-oriented guy, very pragmatic. He got the idea of starting a college in the New World. So he went to the king with this idea that they should found a college in the New World. And for some reason, he thought it should be in Bermuda. And so the king approved it, said, yes, okay, this is a great idea, because we need a college in that world for young people to become ministers so that we, you know, we don't have to keep supplying educated people from, you know, England. They'll have their own, right? So, great idea. So Barclay gets married, figures he doesn't want to set off on a journey like this by himself, so he marries, and he goes to Providence, Rhode Island, instead of Bermuda. And, you know, this is interesting because he feels like what he's got to do first is set up a support a system to support the college. For some reason, I don't know if you've ever been to Bermuda. I guess there's not enough room there for anything but white houses and golf courses. So I don't know, you know, if you could have farms there or not. But so he wants farms in Rhode Island, which will grow the food and things that will supply the college. So while he's in Rhode Island, he ends up having several children because they're there for a while. He preaches in the various neighborhood churches. And that's interesting because he ends up having an impact on the person we might think of as the first homegrown American philosopher, and that is Jonathan Edwards. So Jonathan Edwards. And interesting, Jonathan Edwards is the fire and brimstone preacher, you know, the kind of the icon of that, right? In fact, he's so fiery and brimstony that the one parish decides he's too much for us. You're fired because you're scaring the crap out of everybody, right? So off he goes, right, to the next church. But his philosophy, you know, your religion has to be embedded in a metaphysical view, right? His philosophy is the same as Barclay's. So there actually are homegrown Americans that argue that Barclay coming to the colonies learns this philosophical view from Edwards and then takes it back with him. That seems absolutely stupid to me. It's pretty clear that Barclay comes with that That's his philosophical point of view, and the young Edwards learns it from this European who's there. So that seems, you know, if you get, there's actually books on that controversy, which came first. But in any case, he's interesting. There's a letter. He's written lots of stuff. Which there's obviously a whole book of letters. Ah, okay. This is the one I think that's. So, this one letter is a young person who is converted to being a, you know, fundamentalist Christian by his preaching. And then writes to him, because the puzzle now is, okay, so I'm saved. Now, what do I do? Right? So if you've ever wondered, you know, what do you do once you're saved? I usually respond, well, I've been saved several times. No, it's not, you know, it's not, you're done once, right? And then you're all set. You know, you have to be constantly. So he explains these things, you know, keep earnest about your faith, do not leave off seeking, striving, etc. When you hear a sermon, hear for yourself, though what is spoken may be more especially directed to the unconverted, etc. Though God has forgiven and forgotten your past sins, etc. Remember that, you know, so all this good advice on how to keep the flame burning in your chest, basically, as so he's pretty interesting. He does eventually become the president of New Jersey College, which today we, of course, call Princeton. What's sad about that was that while he's there the first year, really, even he was there as the president of the college, a new thing came out called a vaccine, a smallpox vaccine. And to encourage everyone to trust it, he was the first one that had you know, the vaccine, and it killed him. So that's not really, so he died by proving to everyone that the vaccine was safe. It wasn't, right? So that's kind of sad. But so he's pretty neat. Jonathan Edwards. That ties into an awful lot of things. The burned over district. If you're familiar with the burned over district in New York, where all the revivals come from and so on, although this is before the Methodist brothers Wesley and John Wesley, I forget what his brother's name is, they come and they're Anglicans, but they're upset because the Anglican church is, primarily aimed at the wealthy, who of course are the ones that support the church with their money. But there's all these people that are, you know, the underclass that need their faith and don't really have much from that very staid kind of off-putting, you know, Anglican ritual, right? So they begin preaching to people in the fields, which is very illegal. You're not allowed to do that. You have to be in the sacred space of the actual church. But you know that they ignore it and begin preaching to people directly. And eventually they travel to the colonies and they preach in various, mostly southern, like the Carolinas, that area, where they converted lots of people to what we, of course, call Methodism today. And their method, that was their method, right, to be in the fields and doing that. So that's kind of interesting. But back to George. So George Barclay then, after being there for a few years, begins to realize, hey, the money I should mention this too. Well, don't let me forget, because Berkeley is also on Leibniz's side with regard to the nature of space and time. Remember, Leibniz is the relativist, which we know, of course, becomes our modern physicist's point of view, Einstein, theory of relativity, right? You know, so Leibniz is on the right track. Sir Isaac Newton is a Euclidean, you know, space is structured, you know, like, you know, it's, you know, this is the actual location and things move in that actual location. So for Sir Isaac Newton, space is like a map. You can have a map of where everything is, et cetera. With Leibniz and of course with Einstein, everything is, there's lots of different relative ways of looking at the positions and so on. Berkeley was on Leibniz's side. And by the way, that might be one reason why the British are, you know, they think highly of Berkeley, but they don't promote his view especially strongly. And I think part of it is because he's against Sir Isaac Newton, right? He's, you know, Sir Isaac Newton is like the greatest Brit, you know, as far as the Brits are concerned, you know, the most genius of any British philosopher. And Berkeley had the nerve to argue against Sir Isaac Newton, heck, you know. Notice he's not Sir George Berkeley. He's just George, right? Bishop Berkeley, because he was actually a bishop in one of the poorest parishes they could find for him, right? Where he's so desperate to help his parishioners gain their health back that he's going to experiment with tar water, you know, to try to figure out, is this going to help you, you know, vitamin C, I don't know. But he's waiting in Providence, Rhode Island for the money that the king is going to use to fund the new college, and it doesn't come, so he comes to realize, oh crap, he lied to us. So he gives up the whole project and heads back. The one nice thing, though, that he does, of course, he doesn't ship his books back. He brought this whole library to use to found the college library, and because he... as heading back, he at least donates the books, and half of the books go to Harvard and starts the Harvard Library, and the other half he donates to Yale. And the Yale books are still there. Harvard, unfortunately, had a fire and lost all of them at the Harvard Library. By the way, that's why their motto is, do not kindle fire in the library, because it's bad for libraries if you do that. By the way, you're not allowed to kindle fire in our library, the consortium library. You know, so it really hit one of our students. It was really a shame, but years ago, a group, the 49 State Fellows, one of them was celebrating a birthday, and the others got a cake, and they put candles on the cake, and one of them lit a match and started lighting the candles on the cake, and she was kicked out of the program. Not allowed to kindle fire in the library. So don't do that. Because you know, libraries don't like fire. It's not a good thing.
Is there any connection between Berkeley and Berkeley?
Probably the biggest connection is that I don't know how to pronounce either of them correctly, so it's probably, yes, they are the same. And the California University is named in his honor. But that is odd because the Lawrence Berkeley Labs is not. And that's associated with the Berkeley campus. But if you look up, you know, the University of California, Berkeley, it says there it's in honor of George Berkeley as the first academic that was inspired to create higher education in the New World.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, yeah. So
why is the science library?
Lawrence Berkeley Labs. I don't know if that's a library, but it's
something else.
Yeah, it's an associated, and no relation as far as I know. I tried years ago, I was curious about that relationship myself, and I puzzled it out. There is that university connection, but they're not both in honor of the same Berkeley. 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 I don't know if there's a But there is a particular phrase that's especially associated with Berkeley that's pretty important, and that's "essay is Perkippy." Did we have? Did I pass it already? Let me go. Let me just find it. It's obviously in that page, but so this is. So this is Latin, esse to be, is to be perceived, but it's often expressed with esse is, I-S, perceived, percipi. So this is the phrase to remember for Berkeley when you like go to cocktail parties and stuff and someone says, "Oh, George Berkeley, are you ever study him?" "Oh, of course, esse is percipi." There you go. You're in. You know. You've got all the right credentials, right? It's like the 5-minute university, right? Are you familiar with the 5-minute university? How many of you are familiar with the 5-minute university? Guido Sarducci.
Guido Sarducci. Yes.
Do you remember him? Yes.
Education, I think it don't matter where you go to school, Italy, America, Brazil, it's all the same. It's all just memorization. And it don't matter how long you can remember anything, just so you can pare it at the back for the test. And I got this idea for a school I would like to start. Something called the 5-minute university. And the idea is that in 5 minutes, you learn what the average college graduate remembers 5 years after he or she's out of school. Would the cost of like $20? That might seem like a lot of money, $20 just for 5 minutes. But that's for like a tuition, cap and gown rental, graduation picture, snacks, everything. Everything included. You know, like in college, you have to take foreign language. Well, at the 5-minute university, you can have your choice. Any language you want, you can take it. Say if you want to take Spanish, what I teach you is, ¿Cómo está usted? That means, how are you? And the answer is, muy bien. Means very well. And believe me, if you took 2 years of college Spanish, 5 years after you're out of school, ¿Cómo está usted? Muy bien. About all you're going to remember. So in my school, that's all they learn. You see, you don't have to waste your time with the conjugations, vocabulary, all that junk. You just forget it anyway, and what's the difference? Economics, supply and demand. That's it. Business is you buy something and you sell it for more. Theology, I'm going to have a theology department, since I'm a priest, it's only right. And what you have to learn in theology is the answer to the question, where is God? And the answer is, God is everywhere. Why? Because he likes you. That's kind of a combination of the Disney and Roman Catholic philosophies. It's just perfect for the late 70s or early 80s, Just perfect. Well, after the courses are all over, then it's a time for a little Easter vacation. No time to go to Fort Lauderdale. Only lasts like 20 seconds. But what I do for you, I like to turn on a sun lamp, and I'll give you a little glass of orange juice. That's the snack part, orange juice. And then after vacation, you know, after you swallow it real quick, then it's a time for the final exams. I say to you, como esta usted? You say, muy bien. Where is God? The God is everywhere. Economics is supply and demand. Then I put on your cap and a gown. I get out to my Polaroid camera, you know, make a little snap and flash a picture for you. I give you the picture. You give me $20. I give you a diploma and your college graduate ready to go. I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure, right next door to the 5-Minute University, I might open up a little law school. You know, you got another minute?
So that's Father.
Was funny then. It's not as funny today because probably owe something like $40,000 or $50,000. And the way they've got it set up, the minimum payments you make are really just the interest, so that if you just pay the minimum after 40 or 50 years, you still owe more. So you'll essentially become a slave to the loans that you used to get your college education, which didn't get you a job, because the current economy, there's fewer jobs, et cetera. Plus, computers are going to take over 25% of the jobs, which means 25% of the current employment is going to be...
Only 25%?
Within, like, the next 10 or 20 years.
Going
that's what I've heard.
Like 15 years, they estimate.
Well, there's plenty of new books out on how bad things are going to be because of all the computers. Mm-hmm. So that's interesting. But so, essay is Perkipie. So the one phrase to remember about George Berkeley, essay is Perkipie. For John Locke, tabula rasa. That's the magic phrase, you know, the empty slate, you know. For Thomas Hobbes, it's a dog-eat-dog world, you know, where life is nasty, brutish, and short. You know. So you could just remember the phrases for each of these philosophers, and, you know, that's your 5-minute university for your philosophy course.
If I ever become known as a great philosopher, mine will be, people suck, dogs are cool.
That's actually, I mean, there is the cynic philosophy that is the dog philosophy. So,
yeah.
So that would fit in.
Something about pigs too.
That's George Orwell, I think. When I think of pigs in philosophy, I think of Animal Farm. Okay. They're the animals that, you know, all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. So memorization is actually still good for something, because you essay is Perkipie, tabula rasa. Okay. Anne Foster. I didn't know that. That's George. Okay. So let's make sure. 1685, 1753, Essay Towards a New Theory of Vision, did that. Principles and Dialogues, did that. Essay is Perkipie. Materialists have faith in substance instead of faith in God. That's bad. Everybody's going to become an atheist if we do that. And that seems very prophetic to me, because a lot of people have literally become that. In fact, it seems to me like you have to have gone through Christianity, at least, and then decided that God doesn't exist to be a modern atheist. I don't think you could just not have had any religion and be an atheist officially. I think you have to kind of go through a stage to do that.
It's kind of interesting. If you look at the history of the West, science developed in Christian nations. There obviously was some science elsewhere, but the modern science all developed in Christian nations. So if you look at Christianity as a stage in that development, that in a sense, especially Protestant Christian religion. So all the major development and all the capitalist states were Protestant. Still today, if you think the Catholic countries are still almost third world in a lot of places. So they're still hierarchical, and people believe what the church says, and so you end up with no free thinking enterprise, kind of, the root of the capitalism. Max Weber famously writes a book on the Protestant ethic, capitalism and the Protestant work ethic. There's clearly a connection between Protestantism and capitalism and the social contract philosophers. They're Protestant, right? So it's kind of interesting to see that science evolved out of that, and in a sense seems to be, in my point of view, a Christian worldview. There's a book that's popular right now that just came out a couple weeks ago at the most. It's called The Benedict Option. I don't know if you're familiar with
Benedictine or Benedict Arnold?
No, this is Rod Dreher. He writes for American Conservative? Is it? That's a magazine, the American Conservative, right? So Rod Dreher, he's a minister. So the Benedict is Saint Benedict, not Pope Benedict, but Saint Benedict, the one who started the Benedictines, right? So like the Augustinians, the Jesuits, the Benedictines. So he's the Benedict. And so Rod argues in this book is that this is a post-Christian world we've reached. And so if you're a Christian, what you have to do is basically hide, get yourself safely, out of the world into like a monastery or a community, a Christian community. So get into a Christian community, not in the sense that you're retreating, although that really is. It really looks like you're retreating. But get into that Christian community so you could raise your family away from all of the media and all of the stuff that's most basically anti-Christian, right? So that's his point of view. But I'm thinking, this is the Christian world. This is where Christianity has gone. So I think this is kind of a medieval throwback to that. So if you get a chance to read the book, notice, I don't know, I haven't checked here for a few days. All right, I'll follow it. Silly. Okay, so how many reviews are there now? I won't say. I'm looking for mine.
He sees a trend toward people, instead of migrating from one place to another for jobs, that they're migrating from one place to another for their specific ideology to be surrounded by people with the same thought process.
You don't actually have to move to do that, because you could do it on your computer, because who do you talk to? Wow, some of these are long. They don't even have mine on there.
You were filtered out.
Aha. It was on a filter so that it would only be... But so... So I even had a couple... This is annoying. There's mine. So my question is, I'm reading it and I'm disagreeing with his conception of Christianity. His view of Christianity is that, you know, basically if you're not a fundamentalist, you're not a Christian. And I don't view Christianity that way. So I argued against that. And so what do I... I still gave it 5 stars. I give everything 5 stars. If you take the time out to write a book, I'm going to give you 5 stars for it, because that's a lot of work. Well, I do want good votes.
I might give it 1 star or 0 stars.
However, but if you read it, you go on and read reviews on Amazon. That's, you can always vote for me, by the way. I like votes, getting votes. So okay. Either way, I think everybody. What? Where did it go? I think everybody's done the second test. Have we all done the second test? Any questions on the second test? So if you haven't turned it in yet, please do. But there's no hurry either, as long as I get everything in before the end of the semester. So moving on, shall we take a break? And then go on to David Yoon? Is this any questions on Barclay? Sophie's World? Sophie's World is in English. The original, of course, was in Swedish. But I'm sure that he's sold a lot more books in English than Swedish. But that's a good movie too. It's cute. The way Sophie goes through all the different histories and is introduced to all the different philosophers.
Is that version in English? Or subtitled?
I think the only thing you could find is a subtitled version. Never seen it dubbed. I was interesting that was dubbed in German. I don't know how recent that was, but.
For your first quiz question, it says, do you have a persistence to self? I was wondering if Berkeley talked about that at all.
Yes, and we'll talk more about it with Hume, but the question for Berkeley is, you know, when he's talking with Sophia, right, he says, what are you, right?
Mm-hmm.
If you're not a material body, right? You know, I obviously perceive myself as a material body,
yeah,
but it's actually all spirit, right? So everything that I think of as my physical self is actually energy in my brain that's aware of myself, right? So the question then becomes, well, so what... If there's no persistent object that is you, but instead it's a constantly evolving spiritual set of relationships, you know, what are you really? And when we get to Hume, that becomes really, really significant, because what Hume points out is that you actually have no grounds for thinking of yourself as a persistent self. And part of it, what Berkeley, of course, points out is, I always think of myself, you know, if anything, I'm looking at myself in the mirror. You know, so I'm seeing myself as a reflection, but I'm not actually seeing me. That's my reflection, right? So I never actually am an object for my own subjective
experience. So it's not like, you know, this is clearly an object for me because I almost knocked it over, right? You know, but I never perceive myself in a sense. And yet we obviously think of ourselves as a self. So this gets worse because, you know, even if we use today to talk about, well, I obviously have a body, we don't really doubt that. And I think of this as the body that I've always had, but that's wrong. Because if you look at previous pictures of me in earlier in life, I'm, you know, I don't look like myself anymore. You know, my body's obviously changing. The cells change, what, every 2 years, roughly? And not all of them. And they're, you know, so there's obviously new wrinkles in this, you know, physical cell. And so it's not exactly persistent. Even if I think, well, it's my DNA that's the same. Well, but my DNA, that's an interesting dilemma because DNA is not supposed to change. You know, so I mean, if the FBI, you know, takes a swab, you know, from my mouth and checks it, you know, they'll be able to persistently recognize who I am. So that's an interesting situation. But what we end up with is kind of, this is, I think, where we are today is Thomas Metzinger being no one. So this is there is no persistent self. So there's no one there, right?
The there, you know, not.
Yeah. So what is our modern conception of what we think of as a self? Essentially, I would say it's a social, like a software program that is installed in our social discourse.
Then we get stuck.
And that basically tells me that a person is, you know, an individual that has roles, has a social security number, has relationships, you know, thinks to themselves, right, which not everybody does, actually. But at the same time, it's a process. It's not an object. It's it's an ongoing process. So.
I used to ask people, when you're not looking in the mirror, who are you? And to me, and this goes back to before I was in college, I thought of myself as like 21 years old. You know, I'm stuck in the idea that when I was 21, I could do this. You know, my thought process changed, so I think differently. But I'm physically capable of that, and I'm no longer capable of that. I mean, over the last 10 years, it's become blatantly obvious. But it's like, then I took my first semester of class, I'm surrounded by 18, 19, and 20-year-olds. And it's like, okay, I'm not 21. Okay, maybe I'm 28.
I don't know what the average age of a UAA student is. I think it's pretty high, much higher
it
than.
It is. It's higher than you would expect. I just saw that add up.
Yeah. And there's more women. You know, I think the average is 64% of our student body is female. So
that I don't remember, but I'm sure it's
something
like that. The age is actually much higher than you would guess.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Well, you know, in some ways, I don't think UAA is unique that way. I think that's true of universities across the U.S. that a lot of people engage in a constant education, you know,
right,
as part of their mature years. That they're always going to be connected some way to
self-entertainment,
continuing education,
or growth, job opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And here it's sort of great. I'm not of age yet, but over 62, you take all these classes for free.
Right.
And you're last in line to get in a class, but it's free.
Trust me, you want to wait.
Well,
I agree.
I've had a lot of.
I do want to wait, but that's the only thing I'm looking forward to. That maybe retiring under Social Security, so they throw some money back at me.
Yeah, I get to find that out in August. Actually, earlier than that, I'll be eligible as of August 1st, but I think I put in for it a couple months early.
For under the age 62 or later?
No, I'll be 66 in August. So
you qualify under the 66?
I'm full age, so I should be able to get the full amount of whatever.
Don't do it because they're going to make it not.
Well, I think at 66, that's not an issue.
Really?
I think you could still, if I put in for Social Security before that and I was still earning money, they would deduct it from my Social Security. But at 66, I think that's it. They don't do that anymore.
Okay.
Which is good, because I do plan on keep teaching, even though officially I'll be retired again. So that's going to be interesting, I suppose. My wife is turning 65 in June, and so we began the process of trying to get her Medicare started March 1st. We were supposed to get her set up for Medicare. Well, but because she's always been the housewife, she hadn't earned enough to just go online and get approved. So she has to be approved under my
umbrella
policy, whatever. So you can't do that online. So we physically had to go downtown to the federal building, to the office, where you go in and you sit next to people who are ranting and screaming and saying, "I'm going to kill everybody here." I'm sitting right next to this gentleman who was huge. It looked like he was an ex-Marine or something. I could just kill everyone here. I just strangle them with my bare hands. And I'm sitting right next to the guy reading, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was very hard to concentrate. I was reading Richard Dawkins' new book. But, you know, still, it's hard to read when the guy's sitting right next to you. He's, you know, like, I can kill. You know, the officer was right over there standing at the booth, and he looked older than me, actually. And definitely not even as strong as me, you know, so. So we were hopelessly, you know, under the power of this guy if he decided to actually do something. And I was there for 2.5 hours, sitting there waiting for our number to be called. And finally we got called and we went up and they did the, you know, "Oh, so this is you," and "Yes, we had our marriage certificate." "Oh, okay, all this is good." So she arranged a phone appointment for us. So April 10th, we have a phone appointment, 11:15. So we have to sit there by the phone when it rings, and that's the next step, you know. But no, it's not done yet. So this is fantastic, you know, how this works. When I applied for Medicare, I went online, plugged in my information, and it said, "Okay, we'll send you the results, you know, in 5 days or so." And within 5 days, it had come back approved. So they started billing me right away.
So what age did you apply, and what age are you allowed to apply?
For Medicare? 65. You have to apply at 65.
I have to.
Yep. You have to apply.
So if you don't, they like send somebody out get boots on and
well, you know, not sure, but that was kind of annoying because, of course, we had all this time we've had the free medical coverage from the military.
Right.
And now it's still free medical, except it's more expensive now than it used to be when it was free before.
Right.
We were paying $450 a year for our free medical before. Now I have to pay that every 3 months. So
slightly less.
So my free medical care is four times as expensive as it used to be when it was free before. Let's double think, right? That's 1984, George Orwell. That's George Orwell.
1984.
George Orwell.
Like with Animal Farm Animal Farm is just the short version of 1984 with other characters. So, like, 1984 became very, very popular post November. I'm sort of curious where Animal Farm fit into that.
So that's fun. So, being no one. So, even though we're theoretically not a persistent self, we do have a social security number that's yours for life. I think you could actually change it if you're trying to fix some kind of an economic disaster or something. I think there's a mechanism where you could apply to have your social security number changed, but I'm sure it's a very unique situation that would make you eligible for doing that. Even more strict than, say, just changing your name, if you want to change your name. Which, I mean, like Laura Loft, you know, what's Laura Loft's real name? You know, Troutman, Helen Troutman? I don't know. You guys familiar with Laura Loft?
Yes,
that's kind of, I was listening to her Still Some More this afternoon. And it's really annoying because you get it's like earworms, you know, you get this music in your head, and it just, trying to take a nap this evening, you know, this afternoon, I'm lying there and I, da 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 da, you know, I'm just listening to this stupid music from Skyrim. In multiple languages, no less. You know, so. She does, I think, about 5 languages from the what is it? There's one area where if you download the game or you buy the game, you can have it in English, French, German, Italian, I guess. I don't know if you get it in Russian too, right? You know, you're familiar with?
I didn't know that.
And you know
what
so me. So she's hair is.
I tell you, the dragonborn comes with a voice wielding power of the ancient orders. Believe the dragonborn.
Are you familiar with her then? Nobody?
It's an end to the evil of Scarum's flows. Beware, the dragonborn comes.
You can play it online, I guess, but you can also just play it
isolated
on your machine. My daughter clearly is online with other people because she's also talking and listening to them. So like they're teams going around killing whatever, doing stuff together.
Has anybody made like a game that where people run around doing positive things?
I think so, but they don't sell.
That's the problem. You can gather people together to do all kinds of negativity, but you can't gather them together in big groups to do really positive things.
But this is really intriguing in light of the question about is there a persistent self, because your self can very well move into this virtual online self that is your avatar that you're using in the game. And so, you know, she literally, I suppose this is, you know, you pick what your character looks like, you design your hair, you could choose your sex.
Your daughter has an avatar?
In all the games, yeah. Right? Isn't that, don't you have to?
I'm not the guy to ask.
You pick yourself, and then you start playing, And, you know, so you've got friends and stuff, but...
I'm quite happy not to be on Facebook.
Not missing.
I don't.
And what she's singing about, the Dragonborn, that's one of the races of, isn't it Skyrim? That came about in, like, version 5 or something? Is that right? Anybody? Nobody knows? Well, they have subsequent updates. Like just the other day, was it Monday? Monday night, I think. The 21st.
Yeah.
So it was actually the 20th, because at midnight of the 20th on the East Coast, the new game of... Oh, shoot. Anaconda? No. Mass Effect Andromeda.
But now we know.
Mass Effect Andromeda came out, right? And so she had her receipt, etc. And so you had to pick that receipt up before 7:45, because even though it wasn't the 21st here, it came out the same time. So it was 8:00 in the evening here. So we were over at GameStop. I'm sitting out there reading a book. And she's in line. And I brought my camera because I thought, you know, this is going to be like the Harry Potter thing, right? Where all the people came in costumes and everything. No, nobody came in costumes. They just came. And, you know, they all waited until, you know, 8:00, and they all went in with their receipt to get their copy of the game. And it was so funny because I'm sitting there right out of the storefront, and the two guys that had gone into the one restaurant there to wait for the 8:00 thing, they came out, and the one had a weird hat on, and he was all excited, and he says, "It's about to get real." You know, and I'm sitting in the car thinking, you know, no, it's about to get virtual. It's just the opposite of real. You know, you're going to be in this, you're going to be immersed in this world where you're this character that you get to create, but it's a software world that they've designed it, and they got this young lady singing music that makes you feel like you're saving the world in this world, whereas in this one I'm shit, you know, basically, right? You know, so why on earth would I want to leave that world ever, you know, to come back into this one, you know? I know, you know, some people, you know, they keep a bottle by their computer so they don't even have to get up to go pee.
Yeah, that's
right? Last week, one guy apparently spent 24 hours playing a game and then died. And everyone was worried, you know, did he die because he's playing this game for 24 hours? But it's pretty obvious that...
Well, it's unhealthy to be playing so long and you need to sleep.
Yeah.
He didn't install the catheter correctly or something?
Well, he did get up to go get his pack of cigarettes, and that's when he died. So I'm guessing diet, plus someone said that he had drunk like 4 of those big cans of super caffeine.
Did that really cost you the 4 of those? I mean...
Well, but he was probably not healthy to begin with. That's, you know, it doesn't really tell us... This is a different guy.
Well, I wake up at 5, I'm running since 5:30 in the morning. So it's the first side.
What will you be able to sleep in for an hour and a half?
That's the sad part. It's something like it's so bad.
Really?
22 days. Now, this is the recent one, I guess. So there's more than one out there.
Who's that? The guy? That picture down below?
I think so.
He's not young. I'm thinking like a 24-year-old. He's not 24.
Years ago, I was introduced to Neil Stephenson, the author. You guys familiar with Neil Stephenson at all? Really quite a philosopher, contemporary philosopher. I actually should include him as a that's not going to work. Let me go back here. Snow Crash, exactly. He's got lots of other interesting books out there, but a student said to me, "You have to read Snow Crash." And so I didn't buy it. I went to the Luzac and went, and it was in the stacks. So I went to this place where it was supposed to be, because it was, according to the computer, it was there. Well, I went and I looked, and it wasn't there. That was puzzling. So I went to the old lady and asked her about it, and she went down the elevator to the stacks, you know, where the ghosts are in Ghostbuster. You know, she's that same old lady, actually, you know, where the ghosts made the books all go around and everything. And she came back and handed it to me. So it was in a hidden place so people wouldn't accidentally find it. That was weird, right? But so I checked it out and read it. And the plot of this book is that the main character lives in the real world in California in a one of those storage bins that they, the shipping containers. So he actually lives in a shipping container in LA. That's his life, you know, he just has this little, you know, but that's where his physical body is. But in the computer world, on the internet, he puts on, I guess, like interface goggles or whatever, and he's like a world hero in the internet, drives a motorcycle and is fighting against evil guys. And the evil guys are actually real guys in the world, but they're also avatars in this world, so there's a real conflict between good and bad people, but the bodies, the real persons are living in the world, right? You know, and they're using the internet to interface with one another. And Snow Crash is a program that has been created by these hackers that, you know, if you are handed this card that says Snow Crash and you click on it, which installs it, right, then you see this screen that basically drives you crazy. And you go, and you die, literally, right? So it will kill you if you download this virus, right? So that's the worst virus you can imagine, right? You know, I mean, you know, if you get a virus on a regular computer, it's screwed up, and now, you know, you might be out a computer or whatever. But if you get this virus, it kills you, right? You know? So there's this war, really, you know, between the good and evil, you know, and he's the hero, you know, but it's interesting because, of course, this is all virtual. This is you know, what Neil Stephenson has done is created this futuristic view that most of our lives will be actually on the internet, and the body is really